where do we want to insert the code and what code do we want to insert? These are questions which are related to the problem that you're trying to solve. Okay. And the third question is actually how do we actually go about inserting this extra code? There are various approaches like source code instrumentation and static binary instrumentation. We saw the drawbacks of these. And the most popular approach for instrumentation is dynamic binary instrumentation. It's similar to just-in-time compilation, except that when in just-in-time compilation, we are generating code from bytecode to machine code. In dynamic binary instrumentation, we are generating code from machine code to machine code. And while doing this, generating this code, we can the instrumentation engine insert some extra instruction, extra code in the application. We then learned about PIN. So PIN is a dynamic binary instrumentation engine. It provides a rich set of APIs to write in C or C++ your own instrumentation tools. And these instrumentation tools are called PIN tools. Okay. So PIN tools actually modify the, they can be thought of as plugins. They modify the code generation path in PIN. Okay. As I told you, the PIN tools are C or C++ application. They consist of two types of routines, instrumentation routine and analysis routine. And instrumentation routines are called by PIN whenever PIN is about to generate code for an instruction. Okay? So these an instrumentation routine investigates the static properties of the application and it decides whether it wants to add some extra code over here. It wants to insert a call to analysis routine or not. And if so, it asks PIN to actually inject a call to analysis routine. Okay, and in analysis routine, analysis routine actually define what the instrumentation code would be doing. Okay? So what code we are instrumenting that is actually the analysis routine. Okay, and the important point was that so PIN tool actually registers a callback with PIN that what instrumentation routine do you use. Okay. So do you understand what a callback means? Yeah. What does it mean by a callback? So callback is okay. In the normal way of programming, we actually call a function. So that function is executed at the same time when we call the function. So that is it is synchronous execution. Okay. In callback, we actually register with the runtime engine that this is the function that you have to execute, and it's up to the runtime engine when it wants to execute that function. So it is like an asynchronous execution of functions. So PIN tools are registering with PIN what is the instrumentation function that you have to call, and PIN will call the instrumentation function whenever it is about to generate the about to generate code. Okay. Okay. So this is how we launch PIN. We give the with the dash T command line argument, we specify the PIN tool, and after the double dash, we specify the application that we want to instrument. We can attach PIN to a already running process through by supplying the dash PID argument to PIN. Okay. Okay. Then we saw a PIN tool which was.
It's not actually the compiled file.
Yeah, it's a dynamic library which is built for the PIN tool. So you have to build a dynamic library. So makefiles are there in the PIN kit. I mean, there is a sample makefile provided in the PIN kit. You can directly use it. Most of the time, you guys would be modifying the PIN tools which are already provided. So all the build makefiles are already there for it. Okay. Okay. So then trying to see a tool which was counting the number of instructions. Here what we were trying to do is that just before each instruction, we were trying to insert this counter plus plus. So whenever, so before each instruction, suppose that we have inserted this counter plus plus, so whenever this instruction is about to be executed, the counter would be incremented by one. Okay. So this counter is actually keeping track of the number of instructions which are executed by the application. Okay. So this is how it worked. So when it runs with pin, it displays the number of instructions that are executed. Okay. We are here, we are instrumenting the LS application. You saw the, this is the code for the INS count. Okay. It had, so do count is the analysis routine, instruction was the instrumentation routine, and here INS add instrument function, here we are registering the callback for instrumentation routine with pin. So it is saying that, so it is saying that whenever pin is about to generate code for an instruction, for each an instruction, it should call the analysis routine before it. And in the analysis routine, we were saying that insert a call to this do count function, analysis function, just before this instruction. Okay, just before the code for this instruction, insert a call to the do count analysis function. Okay, and the do count, we were just incrementing the counter by one. And then this, we were registering a callback for a application end event. This, whenever the application is about to end, the fini function would be called, and fini function just prints the I count value. Okay. So focus on this instrumentation call, INS insert call. So the first argument to the INS insert call function is actually through this function call. Pin tool is asking pin to inject a call to analysis routine. So functions, this function takes as input the instruction for which instruction it is asking to inject call. The position, this position is instrumentation position relative to the instruction. We would see about it. And then the analysis routine, and this is a place marker for the end of arguments to insert call. Okay. Analysis routine actually specifies the position relative to an instruction where pin should inject the call to a. Okay. Instrumentation point is a position relative to an instruction where pin should inject a call to the analysis routine. So this JLE instruction is a branch instruction. So it's a conditional branch instruction. Here it is doing the comparison when some flags would be set, and JLE would inspect those flags, and based on that it will either traverse this path or it will jump to this. Okay. So when the instrumentation point is I point before, the analysis call is injected just before this instruction. Okay. And then the instrumentation point is I point after, then the analysis call is injected on the fall through it. By fall through, I mean the instruction which is next to that instruction in the source code. Okay. So here the move instruction is next to this JLE instruction in the source code. Okay. So but this definition of fall through edge actually, so fall through edges may not always exist. Okay. Suppose that here it was a conditional branch, so there were two parts. Okay. But if this was an unconditional jump instruction, there would only be a single path which pin for, only be a single control flow path. Okay. So if suppose that this was a conditional jump, then this path would always be taken. Unconditional jump, then this path would always be taken. So the fall through edge won't always exist. Okay. And if the instrumentation point was I point taken branch, then it actually injects the call on the branch path, the branch taken path. Okay. Are you clear about this?
So if it does not exist, then is it legal to pass it as I point after?
Suppose that the fall through it does not exist and you still pass I point after, it won't actually insert the analysis routine because that path never does not exist. You can always use them, but the analysis call won't happen. Then we saw the second instrumentation tool, which was trying to print the instruction trace. Okay, so it's the instruction trace is just a list of so these are the instruction addresses which are executed. Okay. So we were actually trying to do is that just before each instruction, we were trying to insert a call to this printIP function, which takes as input the instruction address and it just prints it. So here we are passing arguments to the analysis function. So this code is almost similar to the last pin tool. So let's look at the analysis routine. In the analysis routine, it takes as input the instruction address and it just prints in the trace file the instruction pointer. In the instrumentation routine, it's almost the same except that the input arguments to this have now changed. We are passing an additional IARG instruction pointer argument. This IARG instruction pointer argument it is like a macro. Whenever this is passed, the instruction, the address of the current instruction which we are trying to instrument, that address will be passed as a input argument to the analysis routine. Okay. So whatever is placed after the analysis function in this function and before the IARG end would be passed as an input to the analysis routine. Here IARG and IARG instruction pointer is passed as an input.
So we need not to pass IP, we need not to tell what variable we are passing.
Yeah, it will automatically, so here it knows what instruction it is instrumenting, so it can determine on its own what is the instruction's address. There are some other examples. So there are a lot of more arguments which you can. So suppose that we want to pass a 32-bit integer value. So in the previous example, we were just passing a single IARG instruction pointer. Okay. Most of the time, this is not the case. We pass two arguments. The first one specifies the type of the argument that we are trying to pass to the analysis, and the second one is the actual value. So, suppose that we want to pass a 32-bit integer value to the analysis routine. So, in the arguments, we will specify IR32, and then the second argument would be the value that we want to pass. Okay. So this is kind of a shorthand which PIN provides. So here we don't have to explicitly specify the value. We can do something like this. We can say that IR address integer. So this is a type for in addresses. So we are trying to pass an address of an instruction, and then this is the actual value that we are trying. So this IR instruction pointer is a shorthand for this. And then we can pass register values. So this is the type of register value, and this is the register name for whose value we want to pass. Okay. Similarly, this is also a shorthand. It directly determines from the current instruction information, which is the what is the branch target address. Okay. And IR memory of EA. So here we are specifying. So an instruction can have some number of memory operands. So memop is the index of the memory operand, and this is the type of the memory, the effective address of the memory operand. There are many more input arguments. You should read the PIN manual for. Now let's come in to the third. Okay. Okay. So till now, what we have been doing is that we have been instrumenting each instruction in the application. Okay. So we register. So we have been instrumenting injecting a call to the analysis function just before each instruction. Okay. So most of the time that is not necessary. We would actually want to instrument a specific class of instructions. Okay. Suppose that we want to do cache simulation. So here we are only interested in instrumenting instructions which perform a load store, which do a load or a store. Okay, so we are actually interested in only instrumenting such as that. So PIN provides API functions through which we can examine and classify whether what type of instruction this is. Okay. So we would use the PIN API functions to examine whether an instruction is doing a load and a store. Only if it is doing a load and a store, we would inject a call to the analysis routine. Okay. So this is a print tool for printing out the memory trace. The memory trace looks like this. Each line here is the instruction address which did this load and a store, and then whether it was a read or a write, and then the memory address on which it was doing the load or store. Okay. So the pinatrace.so is the tool. It has been taken from the pin manuals. So we run it. So now let's look at the pin tool. So this is a simple C application. So these are the analysis routines. So record mem read. So this would be called whenever there is a memory read, and it is printing. The first argument is taking the instruction pointer which we saw in the last pin 2, and then it is taking a address. This is the memory operand address. Okay. The address of the memory operand, and it is printing the instruction point address, the read, and then the memory operand. Similarly, it is record mem write. It is just printing W, both are same. Okay. I'm not showing the pins initialization in other code, so I'm only doing instrumentation. I'm doing instruction instrumentation, and the instrumentation function is instruction. Okay. So if you look in the instruction function. Okay, so this function would be called whenever the pin is trying to generate code for an instruction. Okay. So this is a pin API function through which we get the number of memory operands. So an x86 instruction can perform more than one load store. Okay. Here I am counting the number of memory operands in the instruction. So x86 instructions have more than one memory operand, and then I'm iterating over the memory operand, and I'm finding out whether it is doing a memory read or a memory write. Okay. So x86 memory operands can be both used as a source and a destination. The same operand can be used both as a source and a destination. So I check for both whether there is no else, both are individual else. Okay. So if it is doing a memory read, then I insert a call. So forget about this INS predicated call. INS insert predicated, this is almost similar to INS insert call which we saw previously. And we pass INS the instruction, the position instrumentation point, INS before. Then because this is a read, so we call the read analysis routine. And then we pass the instruction address just like in the previous, and we have to also pass the memory operand. So the memory operand is passed like this. So we give IR memory operand A, and then we give the memo. Okay. So we discussed this previously that this was a shorthand, and here we are passing two arguments. So they both would be used to pass the second argument. Okay. Do you get what is happening over here? And similarly for write, so whenever it is a write, we are just changing them and calling the memory write analysis function. So here we are injecting, so suppose that an instruction is doing both read and write, the same instruction. So we are injecting first two analysis calls to two different analysis routines, okay? And whenever that is about, that the analysis routine is about to be executed, it will pass the instruction pointer and it will pass the memory operand. So now what happens is that the memory operand in most of the x86 instructions is determined at the runtime, okay, when the instruction is actually going to be executed. So when we are doing the instrumentation, at that point we do not know what is the memory operand's address. That would only be known when the instruction is about to be executed. So first question was actually that why can't we pass here, so when the instruction is about to be executed, at that point we have to again look up the instructions environment to find out the memory operand. Okay.
So basically that get converted into some calculation.
Yeah, it gets, so this memory of EA and memop, this would get converted into some code which will find out the instructions memory operand's address, and that would be passed to the record mem. Okay.
So here I guess I could also then interpret at runtime whether it's a read or a write. But here I'm doing it to save an analysis work.
Yeah. Well, we know that information before. Just like decoding the instruction.
Yeah, so that I'm just trying to point out that, you know, you should try to do as much as you can at instrumentation time. Reduce your runtime overhead. So here also I could move the read write checking at runtime correctly, but I'm not doing it.
Yeah. I mean you can even move I've not displayed that memory operand. So we can also pass the program's context, the execution context, as a input argument to an analysis routine.
Yes.
So we can
do everything at once.
Yeah. But the overhead of that is quite large. The instrumentation actually slows down. So we should most of the time do most of the work during the instrumentation time, because that is called once and the analysis routine should do the minimal work. So are you clear about this?
So you are going to talk about the predicated call?
Yeah, I forgot. Okay, so here we are doing INS insert predicated call. I mean, so x86 has some instructions which have some predicate before them, and only if the predicate is true, the instruction is actually executed. So so the predicate is itself a part of the instruction. Only if the predicate is true, the instruction would actually be executed. So the predicates are like some conditions. So let's talk about instruction granularity. Till now we have been So till now we have been registering a callback to a instruction instrumentation routine. So this function actually said whenever pin was about to generate code for our instruction, it should call the instrumentation routine. So we were actually instrumenting at the granularity of each instruction. So we were calling the instrumentation routine for each instruction. The overhead of this is quite large. So pin provides other instruction granularity. You can call the analysis instrumentation routine at basic block. So now let's first see what these are. So a basic block is a sequence of instructions which are terminated by a control flow changing instruction. So whenever you have a suppose that this is the code sequence, and so this was a control flow instruction, so this is one basic block and it starts, this is second basic block, okay. And then there is trace is a sequence of basic blocks which are terminated at a unconditional control flow changing. So this whole is a single trace, so the trace won't be terminated here because the trace is terminated at a unconditional flow, okay. So pin provides you these other API calls to register instrumentation routines for doing basic block level instrumentation and trace based instrumentation. So when I say trace based instrumentation, that means whenever PIN is about to generate code for a trace, it should call the analysis routine. Till now we were saying whenever PIN is about to generate code for an instruction, it should call the analysis routine. Now we would be saying whenever PIN is about to generate code for this whole trace, it should call the analysis routine. Okay. So we have seen instruction based instrumentation. We would see example of these in, and then the fourth type is routine based instrumentation. Routines are functions. So this is almost similar to instruction. It says that whenever PIN is about to generate code for an instruction for a function, it should call the analysis routine act before that. Okay.
So apart from instruction counting, the basic block and trace, do they have benefit?
Yeah, we would see when, what. Okay. Okay. So, so this was the instruction count too. Okay. So we were injecting this counter plus plus just before each instruction. So this is not that efficient mechanism of counting instructions because we have to. There are a lot of additions that this code would have to do. Okay. That. So this is a straightforward mechanism, but it is not that efficient. Can you guys think of another type of what? How can we optimize this further?
That's a good question. Actually.
We have to count the, still the number of instructions, but can we do somehow? I mean, reduce this number of analysis calls that we are inserting. So this is the same code. It consists of two basic blocks, okay? And a basic block has a single entry point and a single exit point. It does not. So what we can do is that just before the start of the basic block, we can count the number of instructions in the basic block, and we can just increment the counter by there. So this would be so instead of doing three additions, we are doing now a single addition. Similarly for the second basic block.
Yeah, so here, of course, the point is that basic blocks are static entities. So
yeah.
You count the number of instructions in a basic block and instrumentation. So that's the whole point. Right?
Yeah.
Otherwise, I don't see any.
How do you know the count of instructions in basic
block? I mean, why?
Because,
so we would see how we get the count.
No, otherwise, if I'm counting. Yeah, means, I mean, how do I know 3, for example, here, counter plus equal to 3, you're saying, if I'm counting number of instructions that execute, I mean, at runtime, then of course there is no gain, but I'm doing the same thing. If, only if I can discover that there are 3 instructions to the instrumentation interface, then only I have a gain, right?
Yeah.
And I think you can do that because basic blocks are static entities. You know, number of instructions in a basic block is not going to change. The only thing that's going to change is how many times.
So that's because the basic block has a single entry point and a single exit point. That's what, so because of that, the number of instructions would remain the same.
Yes.
So
let's see how
we do. So we have to figure out what are the basic blocks, and we have to count the number of instructions in the basic block, and we inject. So okay, so let's see the code for this. So this is the. Our analysis routine has changed. It has a input argument C, which it increments the I count by that C. And this is our instrumentation routine. We will come to this. Let's focus on this callback function. So instead of doing INS add instrument function, we are doing trace add instrumentation instrument function. So here we are doing registering a callback for trace instrumentation. So whenever PIN is about to generate code for a trace, it will call this trace instrumentation function. Okay, now let's look at the instrumentation function. Here what we are doing, so a trace was just a sequence of basic blocks, okay? So it can be thought of as a list of basic blocks. So here in the instrumentation function, we are actually iterating over the basic blocks in the trace. So we get the head basic, so trace is a list of basic blocks. So we get the head pointer, and we are checking whether the basic block is on visible again. Then, so this is the, this is, okay. And in each iteration of this for loop, we are saying, we are asking pin to inject a call at the start of the, just before it generates code for the basic block, okay. So previously we were doing INS insert call, that was saying just before it generates code for the instruction, it should inject call to the analysis. Here we are saying that just before it generates code for the basic block, we should insert a call to the analysis routine. Okay. So we are iterating over the list of basic blocks, and we have this, we inject a call. So for each basic block, we inject a call to this lookout function. Okay. The input arguments here are, we pass 32, IR 32, and this is the value that we are trying to pass. We can find out the, so this is a pin API function which gives us the number of instructions in the.
And this one executes at instrumentation time, right? BPL
yeah.
underscore numbers.
Yeah.
So essentially it's, it passes a constant to
yeah.
The yeah, so roughly that's what I was saying.
Yeah.
It counts only once.
Yes.
Is,
yes.
Yeah, we have this information at instrumentation time, how many instructions are there in the basic block, and we inject a call to this do count function with the number of instructions in the basic block at the start of the basic block. Okay. So here the instrumentation function is taking as input the trace for which pin is about to generate code, and yeah, and the second argument is the second argument passed over here. We do not use it, so we just pass zero. Okay. So do you get this? Here I said that we can do instrumentation at different granularities. We can do instrumentation at basic block. So we were actually doing, so in the example we saw, we were actually calling the instrumentation function at the granularity of trace, and we were injecting analysis routines at the granularity of basic blocks. Okay. There is no specific instrumentation routine to register a callback for basic block. Okay. So there are only two instrumentation the two add instrument function. One is INS add instrumentation, and there is trace. Other is trace add. We can only register instrumentation callback for either instruction level or for the trace level. And in the trace level, we can iterate over the basic block. So there was one more of the routines. Now we will see an example for how to do this routine-based instrumentation. So this is procedure instruction count. This is also taken from the pin manual. Okay. So this is how. So this is the tool proc count.so, and this is the instruction that we are instrumenting. We are doing a grep on. We are trying to find this thing in the make file. Okay, this is the output. And this is the, so this actually creates a file proccount.out, and this is the output of proccount. Can you see this clearly? So it gives us the name of the function, which it, and it prints the library which is providing this function, and it prints the address of the starting of the function, and print the how many calls were made to this function and how many instructions are there in the function. Okay. So this is a part of the print tool. So we define some structure which, so RTN means routine, which is same for a function. The structure tracks the name, and this is the name of the image, the library, which is the address. This is all the information that was printed over here. Okay. This is a pointer to the routine. This, the RTN, how many times it is called, and the number of instructions. So this will be used to make a linked list of the RTN, okay? And then we pass a pointer to it, and it just increments. This is our analysis routine. We pass a pointer to it, to an integer variable, and it just increments it by one. Okay? And this is just to get some path. Okay. This is the. This is the main, this is the instrumentation function, and we are doing RTN add instrument. So whenever pin is about to generate code for a function, it will call this instrumentation routine.
Okay. So in the instrumentation routine, we get the routine for which it is about to generate code. We create a new object of the RTN count or the structure. RTN count is this structure. We create a new object for this routine. We initialize its name. These are pin API functions to get the name of the routine. So I will explain this afterwards. This is something to get the name of the library.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. This is to get the name of the library. Okay. We initialize the library's name. We get the address of the routine. We set I instruction count to 0. We do routine. How many times the routine is called to also 0. And okay. So we are preparing a linked list of the routines which are called. So this is RTN.
Head of the list.
Yeah. This is RTN list is the head of the list.
Okay.
So we are saying routine dash next is the current head of the routine, and we set the new head as the newly created routine. Okay. So whenever we are about to instrument a routine, we should have. Okay, I will talk about this afterwards. Okay. Now let's look at this. This is the main instrumentation part. This was just the initialization. Here we are doing RTN insert call. This is similar to INS or trace insert call. And we are passing routine, the position I point before the routine. The analysis function is do count. And we are passing the IARG. Okay. So this is a input type for a pointer that we are trying to pass. Okay. And we are passing a pointer to RTN count. Okay. So we are adding a call to do count function just before this routine, and we are passing the do count the RTN count. RTN count is actually trying to maintain how many times that routine is being called. Okay. So whenever the routine is about to be called, this do count will also be called, and it will increment this RTN count by 1. Okay, so it will count the number of times this function is being called. So the second thing. Okay.
Yeah, this is a dynamic count.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now we are iterating over the routine, the instructions in the routine. So we get the head instruction at the starting of the routine, and we. If the instruction is valid, we keep on. Okay, so we are iterating over the instruction. So a routine is just a, can be thought of as a linked list of instructions. So we are iterating over that linked list, and then we are doing a instruction instrumentation, and we are just instrumenting a call to do count before this instruction, and we are passing this iCount variable of this structure as a input argument. So whenever instruction in that routine would be executed, it will count the, it will increment this I count by 1. Okay, so this I count would actually count the total number of instructions which are executed by that routine in all the invocations of that routine. Yeah, we could have optimized this by doing similarly, breaking down it in basic blocks and addition. So one more thing, just before doing the instrumentation, we have to do this, we have to open this routine, RTN open and then close. So this is okay.
So the instruction list is provided by pin?
Yeah. All this information is provided by pin. Okay. RTN, again, these are API functions to get. So pin actually maintains it like this. Routine structure as a list of instructions.
So if you go back now to your that thing where the list is shown.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the, if I add up the last column, I'll get total number of dynamic instructions.
Yeah, but I do not see any. There must be the main function in the program. So how to pin tools are all C++. We can debug them. So debugging them is slightly different. So we use GDB for debugging. So whenever you have to first compile them with -g,
argument.
How many of you have not used GDB? Very nice. So learn that. Okay. That will be needed for this course. Unless you are a great coder, you'll never be a GDB person.
Okay. So you first do GDB pin in one terminal, and you do not run anything here. So just start this and wait. And in second terminal, you actually call your pin routine, but you also pass this pause tool command line argument. And this is the number of seconds that. So what this will do is that after starting the program, it will wait for these many seconds. After that, it will start the program. Okay. So you can pass anything over here. Okay. In this 10 seconds, you have to go back to this terminal and you have to execute these. Okay. So it will print this thing. Okay. So you have to print the PID of this process. In this terminal, you have to do attach to this PID. So what it will do, it will attach this to this terminal. And then you can do all break, you can insert break points.
Essentially, you're attaching GDB
yeah.
to the main process.
Yeah. So here, after you do attach, you can create breakpoints and do a continue. And when you do this, it will also print a line which says the, it basically displays a command. Which is to so to add the symbol information of the pin tool in with GDB. Okay. So after doing attach, you should execute that command that it printed. I'm not showing that here, and it will attach the symbol information also. Okay. And then you can insert as many breakpoints and so this is the last slide and. This is the link to the PIN manual. You can also find it on the homepage of PIN. You should go through it. There are a lot more examples in it. And you should read them. Then there is a PIN news group. If you have any questions, you can ask them. You can post on this. And if you have any other questions, you can ask me. This is my email ID. And this is my
email. Okay, thanks.